Good morning. Welcome to worship today. It is good to be back with all of you. And I want to thank you for your prayers as I was sick and for your ongoing prayers for me as well. I invite you to rise as we begin with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace.
Amen.
Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son, so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Church of God and
Let us pray. Merciful God, the foundation of living water, you quench our thirst and wash away our sin. Give us this water always. Bring us to drink from that well that flows with the beauty of your truth. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
First lesson today is from the book of Exodus. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of Israelites joined by stages as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why do you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Today's second lesson is from the book of Romans, the 5th chapter. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit and has been given to us. For while we were still weak, in the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, we will be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely have we been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite any young people forward for a children's sermon. Good morning. I brought something to show you today for the children's sermon, but it's actually nothing that it's nothing special that I had to bring because I bring it every week. I don't know if anyone notices, I usually have this with me during church. Have you ever seen me take a drink of this? Yeah, okay, well, I do a lot because when I'm speaking, I get thirsty. I want to make sure my voice is clear and I can speak and everyone can hear me well. So I keep this back there with me, and then if I remember, I bring it up here too. So I'm going to set it there before I forget. And then I have this one. This is what I bring it to church in. I have more than one water bottle, though. And some people call their water bottles an emotional support water bottle. Oh. Does anyone ever like have to have a water bottle with it? Do any of you have a water bottle you carry everywhere? Yeah, like if you're going somewhere, especially in the summer and it's hot, you need that water in case you get thirsty. Well, I have to have mine wherever I go. Yeah? I bring mine with me when I'm shopping. I bring it with me to church, obviously. I bring it with me anytime I'm in the car for a long time. I just have to have it. Now, I do drink from it. It's not just there for fun, but it's there because I know I might get thirsty. I just get thirsty a lot, but that's okay because we need water, don't we? So I always have it with me, except for when I forget. Well, I want to show you something. I'm going to, you all know, I'm sorry I wasn't here last week. My friend came, Shelly came instead. You know her?
Yes.
From, yeah. She's pretty cool, huh? So that was nice of her to come. He didn't know for until a few days before that she was going to fill in for me. So that was really nice. Well, what was I going to say? Sometimes I do forget my water bottle. But that's right, I was saying I was not feeling well, but I just washed my hands. And I wanted to tell you, so I almost always have my water bottle with me for when I'm actually thirsty. But you might have heard about this in Sunday school too. We're going to talk about a really cool story in the Bible called The Woman at the Well. And let's see, what? Here, will you come over here with me? We don't always have something in here. And you know, I'm not sure exactly why. But I think it might be because because when COVID happened, we didn't necessarily want people's fingers all getting in here. Do you know what's in here?
Baptism.
Yeah, water. Were you all baptized? Does anybody remember their baptism?
I remember hers.
You remember hers? That is just as good, so you can remind her of it.
Oh, I remember my brothers.
You remember your brothers?
Nobody.
I don't remember mine. Would you like to push that open? Can you reach it? Would you like to do it? Uh-huh. Or you can push it from here, I think. Which way does it go? Push this part of it. Push. Keep pushing. You can do it. Use your whole hand. There's water in there today. Oh, are you okay? I didn't pinch your finger? Okay. Well, I washed my hands too, and I put clean water in, but I think maybe the reason we didn't have this filled up with water more is because of COVID anyway. When you were baptized, the pastor took water and put it on your head, and maybe you cried a little. I know a lot of babies don't like it if it's cold. We try to do warm water for that. And then after you're baptized, the pastor would go with a special, it can be with water or it can be with a special oil too. And they'll say, you're a child of God. And they make the sign of the cross and they say, you have been marked with the cross of Christ forever. Can you reach it? Well, I want all of you to remember that you can do that sometimes. Remember that you are God's. And oop. This is what we call living water. It's okay to splash around and play in it. And you can, like when you're taking a bath or a shower, you can say, I'm a child of God. So does everyone want to do that today? Do you want help reaching it? You can reach. Do you want help reach? Do you want to dip your finger in? Or maybe you can always come back later too and say, I am a child of God. Perfect. Anybody else? Okay. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for calling us your children. Thank you for giving us living water.
Thank you for giving us living water.
And loving us always. Amen. You got some, right? To be seated for this very long gospel reading. If you really want to stand, that is fine too, but I think it's quite long and maybe you'll hear the words better if you're seated. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the fourth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? And with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you know now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshiped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I had ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat." Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say, 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that the sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I have sent you to reap for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor." Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I have ever done." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It's no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard it for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Not all water is the same. Jesus is telling us this. Today in our gospel, how do we choose what kind to drink or where to drink it from? We have many choices. We have such a gift and privilege that we can drink water from our homes, we can go to the store, and we don't just go and get one kind of water. No, we have many options. We can get spring water or distilled water or alkaline water or reverse osmosis water. We can get designer water. I could go on and on. And then if that's not good enough, we could get Gatorade or Powerade or vitamin water. No matter what kind we drink or where we get it from, the simple truth is that we need water to live. In John, Jesus sits at a well and speaks to a woman of Samaria. he shouldn't be doing this. His disciples do not like that he's doing this when they come back and find out. But Jesus has chosen this woman to share the good news with Samaria, a people that were similar to the Jews but did not believe in the same things. He shouldn't be doing this, but he's chosen this woman. She's come to the well around noon, the hottest part of the day, not when the others come. There's a reason, I don't know for sure, but she's really not one with all the people in her community. She's probably had a rough life as well. Still, this woman is chosen. And Jesus tells her about her own life in order that she would know he is not just an average rabbi or an average Jew. And she believes he's a prophet. And that's true in some ways, but he's much more than that, as we know. Jesus was sent from God. So like prophets, he carries a message from God. But he is God as well. And he came to earth to share God's love with all people, to set an example of God's love, and to sacrifice himself for us. He became vulnerable and human. And Jesus knew what it was like to be thirsty, to be hungry, to feel pain. But he also got to share in some of the joys of being alive. He wasn't looking to share the good news only with those who had lived simple or seemingly perfect lives. And so he tells this woman about the water of life. And he says, everyone who drinks from this water will be thirsty again. I think saying the word thirsty is making me thirstier. But those who drink from the water I give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give them will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. And the woman said, sir, give me this water so that I won't be thirsty again and I won't have to come back to this well. She said she was waiting for a Messiah who would proclaim all things. And that day she didn't just hear about it or see it, she experienced it through Jesus himself. And I can't imagine the amazement or shock or what helped her have faith that Jesus was this person she was waiting for. But she believed, and she was excited, so much that she left her jug by the well, didn't bother to even carry it with her or bring it back full. Maybe that would have slowed her down too much, and she had important news to share with everyone. This was a leap of faith because Samaritans had a similar but different faith. And she met Jesus and took a leap of faith to believe that there was something different about him. He was no ordinary rabbi. Jesus says, I am the Messiah. This phrase he uses at other times in the Gospel of John, like when he says, I am the bread of life. But this is only the only time that he uses that phrase to say to anyone that he is the Messiah. And he chooses this woman to share it with. She knows it's significant, and so she quickly goes to tell everyone. I wonder if she left her jug because she forgot that she was thirsty or she forgot her responsibilities of bringing that water. I'm sure she went back and didn't forget. The people of the city would have known her history well. And she tells them, come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. She's excited about it. She is not ashamed. So from there, many went from the city to follow her and to meet Jesus. And we're told many Samaritans from the city believed in him because of the woman's testimony and Jesus' word. Jesus offers us all living water. And yet in Lent, we focus on the fact that we thirst for other things. We long for other things that we think will make us happy. We take water for granted. We take so many things in life for granted. There's a song I've known about for over half my life as I was thinking about it. I remember listening to it in high school. It's been by Jennifer Knapp, and it's called When Nothing Satisfies You, or When Nothing Satisfies. And sometimes I listen to it when I sort of I feel that in my life, that nothing is satisfying, or even when I can't find a song that's good enough, I go to that song. And I remember that there's nothing in the world that will give me peace the way that God can. And some of the words say, when it rains or it shines on this pillow of mine, I will lift up my head to the sky. So I have chance to see where my hope has come from. No, there's nothing that I can't abide. And the chorus repeats these words. When nothing satisfies you, when nothing satisfies you, hold my hand. And so I imagine Jesus holding my hand. When nothing satisfies me, when nothing else gives me peace. The song has always brought me comfort when I look for peace in other ways. Like when I think that if I had more money, then I could be happier. Or if I could just buy one more of this or that, my life would be easier. But nothing I buy can give peace like God. Or a feeling of being in the presence of God. It's in the presence of God, too, that we can admit that we do not always reflect the love that God has shown to us. Our hearts are not always in the right place. We don't always live from a place rooted in the living water, trusting in the living water. No matter how hard we try, we can't love others as perfectly as Jesus loved us. No matter what, though, we are gifted with God's love and grace because we are God's people. It's clear in a lot of ways that Jesus knows that not everyone is on a level playing field in society. Jesus himself experiences this. He has no earthly title or formal authority. He sacrificed much of his power he could have had. But he has the power to proclaim the kingdom of God, the power to heal, and he speaks the good news to all people, especially this woman. This woman at the well is one of God's children. We are God's children. We are all God's people. And we have been created in the image of God. We've been given living water, and we have gifts to give God as well. Remember, Jesus asked this woman for a drink of water himself. There was something that she could help him with on this earth. And not just the living water, but sharing the good news. God needed her. God needs our voices and our love of each other, our neighbors, to be lived out and shared with one another. We all get thirsty at times, and we know we need water to live. But we also know we have been given living water. Through water and word, we are called children of God. When we affirm our baptism, we remember we are called to do many things. And this is actually out of the hymnal that I want to read from. We are called to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. And God calls us God's children. This is quite the task, but I think we're up to it. We are told to share this love with all people. We remember that this is a love that sustains us in hard times. This is a love that is present with us now and throughout eternity. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. We pray for your church. Bless partnerships with other Christians and interreligious dialogue. Guide the daily work of denominational and congregational leaders. Strengthen our combined witness for the sake of the gospel, that all experience your life-giving love. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for the universe. All creation teems with life. From the depths of the earth and seas to the skies above. Fill us with awe and reverence for the diversity and perseverance of life, the preservation of life. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for the nations of the world. Topple the dividing walls that separate us from our neighbors. Form us into your beloved community, where diversity of gender, race, language, ability, and ethnic origin is celebrated and affirmed. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. Be present with all who are lonely, and give courage to all who are afraid. Comfort those who live with chronic illnesses or other sicknesses, especially those that we say aloud or silently in our hearts. Thank you, Mary, Paul, Lord. Give them your living water always. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for this congregation and for those who visit. Nurture our faith and pour your love into our hearts. Inspire our community to testify to God's grace in their lives. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We give thanks for the lives of all of your saints, their hope in you sustained lives of faith and service. Encourage us with the hope that they share in you. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of the peace with someone around you. Please rise. Let us pray. God of good gifts, receive these and all our offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Please rise. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Embody God, at your table, we have tasted the goodness of Jesus. With the eyes of our hearts open to your promise, empower us to hear the needs of our neighbors and to touch the world with your love. Amen. The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.